Good morning. Welcome to Myerstown Church of the Brethren. And we greet you. I had in my notes this beautiful day, but it is beautiful, even if it's raining. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And for the announcements this morning, we remember to pray for those on our prayer list, and this week those on page 56 in the church directory. Also this week we're praying for the Ridgeway Community Church in Harrisburg, and Skipack Church in Collegeville is praying for us. I'm not sure if everyone in the congregation knows, but we want to extend our sympathy to the George Heller family. George passed away this past Thursday, so please keep Ruth and the family in our thoughts and prayers. Some highlights from the bulletin. Pumpkin roll baking will start Monday, September 25th. And next Sunday, we'd like all the students in the congregation to bring their school backpacks to church for the back-to-school blessing of the backpacks. Check for your bulletins for the changes that are taking place in our church library and on the tables out in the gathering place. And also see the announcements of the upcoming events for Londonderry Village. There's also a page in the bulletin about camping events taking place at Camp Swatar for families and children in October. So those of you, especially with young children, please be aware of that and check the online for the details. Does anyone else have any additional announcements or comments on the ones that I have mentioned? Anyone else? Well, if not, let us quiet our hearts and our minds and prepare for worship as Barb leads us in the prelude. Thank you, Barb. And now will we all rise for the call to worship? This is taken from Psalm 32. Happy are those whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Happy are those to whom the Lord imputes no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. Now let us join in singing our hymn, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee, which is page 71 in the blue hymnal. Now let's bow our heads for the invocation prayer. Father, we come to you this morning and ask your blessing on this service and this time we share with you. Please calm our hearts, calm our minds, so that we can hear what you have to say for us this morning. And we pray that what this service holds for us will continue throughout the coming week. We ask this all in your precious Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen. You may now be seated, and we'll have Earl and Cindy and Barb come up and minister to us.
To see you. see you. I want to see you. Strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all.
Seeking you as a precious jewel. Not to give up, I'd be a fool. You are my all in all.
Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your
Thank you so much. Now for this morning's scripture, I'd like to read for you Psalm 32, 3-10. While I kept silent, my body wasted away, though my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me, my strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not hide my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let all who are faithful offer prayer to you. At a time of distress, the rush of the mighty waters shall not reach them. You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with glad cries of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. Do not be like a horse or a mule without understanding, whose temper must be curbed with bit and bridle, else it will not stay near you. Many are the torments of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds those who trust in the Lord. Now let us rise and join in singing Ancient Words, and it'll be on the screen.
Thank you.
our morning prayer. Dear Father, we come to you with thankful hearts this morning, thankful that we're able to come together to worship you and to fellowship with other believers. We thank you, too, that we live in a country where we're still free to worship you openly. We ask your blessing on our country and its leaders. Give them the wisdom that they need. We pray for those who are being persecuted for their beliefs today, and be with the whole situation in Afghanistan. We know you're there with them. We also pray for the people of Haiti recovering from both earthquake and hurricane. We also pray for those in the New England states that are now feeling the effects of Hurricane Henry. Father, we thank you for our health. Protect us from the COVID virus so that we can continue to worship here openly. Please give us the wisdom we need on how to protect ourselves and our family, and help us to be more understanding with those that have different opinions on how to do that. Father, we pray for this church here in Myerstown. We pray for those in leadership that you will give them the wisdom for the direction we need to go in the future. Help us as a church to be a shining light to those in the community, those around us, and for them to see you in us. Father, we come to you this morning with many of us having heavy hearts. Some are hurting silently, not wanting others to know. Comfort them, Father. Bless and comfort those that need your healing, and stay close to those that are grieving with a special blessing for the George Heller family. We ask your blessing on this service, Father, and please give Pastor Ron your words to say, the words that we need to hear today. Be with us all this coming week, and we ask these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Please rise as we sing, Lord, Listen to Your Children Praying, and page 353 in the blue hymnal. You may be seated, and now the children may come front for their children's nap. Okay, did you all have a good week? These are all ready to go back to school, those of you that are going back? No? This morning we're going to have a little bit of a different children's story. I'm sure as you've been growing up, your parents have told you all the wonders of nature, all the wonderful things, and everything comes from God. Let's say like rainbows after a storm, beautiful sunrises, sunsets, birds, trees, and all of them come from God, right? Well, I'm sure we all enjoy, or how many here like to see butterflies? Do you like to see butterflies? Do you remember that song, you know, I Wish I Were a Butterfly? Okay. I'm not going to sing it, believe me. Anyway, well, this morning I'd like to tell you about a little hobby of mine. A few years ago, I mentioned at a family dinner that I couldn't figure out why I had all these weeds in my garden. And we were talking about them, and they were milkweeds, and they just kept growing and growing and growing, and I kept pulling them out. Well, as we were sitting there, my granddaughter, Abby, heard me say this, and she set me straight and told me that I must keep them because butterflies like them. Well, I did some checking, okay? And I found out that monarch butterflies lay their eggs on milkweed, and then in time, they turn to butterflies. And I'll show you, this is what a monarch butterfly looks like. Okay. Now I'll show you how this works, okay? In my garden, I do have milkweed, and the butterflies come there and they lay their eggs on this milkweed. Now that milkweed down there, it was nice when I put it in. It's kind of all dried up now. But anyway, they lay their eggs on there and then they hatch into caterpillars. Can you see the caterpillars down there? There's two of them. Can you see it? Okay. Well, I put them in there, and I have a bigger one than this, but anyway, I put the caterpillars in there, and they grow, and they grow, and when God tells them, I guess, that they're ready to turn into butterflies, they climb up to the top, and can you see that little thing up here? He wasn't very cooperative, and he didn't put it in the middle. Can you see that thing? It's like a cocoon. It's called a chrysalis, okay? And about 10 days later, that chrysalis will turn black. And can you believe a big butterfly comes out of that? And just for the older ones here, if you ever want to see this, go on, just Google it, and you can see how that butterfly can come out of there. And then, after he comes out and he dries off, then we let him go. And here's a picture of my great-granddaughter helping me let one go. Okay? And then, do you know where they go after they come out? They fly the whole way to Mexico and then come back again next year, okay? So I hope you enjoyed that. It's just one of those things that God, it's a miracle. That's all I can say. And it's just so wonderful to see that God does that. And I'd like this week for you to think about all the different things that God creates miracles in your life, especially in nature, okay? Could we bow our heads for a prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, bless each one of these children, especially those that are going back to school, that it's always a little bit of a nervous time for them, so comfort them and help them do well and keep them healthy and safe. We thank you for all the miracles that you have given us in our lives, and thank you for giving us these blessings. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen. And you can go to children's church. Okay, now I have to figure out where I am. Okay, the next thing is our scripture reading will be from Matthew 4, 1 to 11. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, 'One does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God.'" Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on a pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, 'He will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, and so that you will not dash your foot against a stone.'" Jesus said to him, "Again, it is written, 'Do not put the Lord your God to the test.'" Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." And Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, 'Worship the Lord your God and serve only him.'" Then the devil left him, and suddenly the angels came and waited on him. And now we'll turn the service over to Pastor Ron Brubaker. I'm sure we're all familiar with him, as he had been our moderator for a few years, and he's from the South Lebanon Community Church.
Hey, it is good to be here again. Like she said, I was here a number of years as your moderator, so most of you I am not a stranger to. A couple of things I need to say before I get to the sermon. This pulpit's not very big. Can I do something? Can I steal this? I place my Bible in that, it'll work. And I do have a coughing asthma. If I cough a couple of times, it's just because of the asthma. I am not sick. Another thing I need to tell you You know, it was my years when I was here as moderator when I went through my cancer journey. And a number of people have asked me already how I'm doing. I have just passed my five-year mark, and I have been declared cancer-free. Had the five-year checkup back in June, and the doctor told me my chances of cancer are no greater than anybody else's. So I am feeling great. Anyway, the sermon title this morning is Temptation. And, you know, when you talk about the subject of temptation, every one of us is tempted. You know, different people struggle with different temptations, and what tempts you might not tempt me, and what tempts me might not tempt you, but all of us are tempted. And the question is, how do we, when we are tempted, not fall into sin then? Because it's not a sin to be tempted, but it's a sin when you then fall into temptation. And let me start with a story. The story is told of a young couple who was struggling to make ends meet. Because they had the temptation, and then they would fall into the temptation to spend more than they were making. So they were in deep financial trouble. So they talked about how they could solve this problem, this temptation of their finances. And they decided the only way this would work is if they hold each other accountable. And by holding each other accountable, they would not buy anything without discussing it with their spouse. And things were working out pretty well. Less money was being spent until one day she went to a department store and she saw this beautiful dress. And she couldn't resist the temptation to at least try it on. I mean, she reasoned, I don't have to buy it. I just want to try it on. Well, she tried it on. It fit perfectly. It looked good on her. And she fell for the temptation, and she bought it. And when she gets home, he sees what she has bought. Her husband sees what she has bought. He says, what did you do? Didn't we agree that we would not buy anything without discussing it with the other? And she defends herself. She says, I couldn't resist the temptation. It fit perfectly, and it looked good on me, so I bought it. And he says, why didn't you say, get behind me, Satan? And she says, I did. And he says, it looks good from the back, too. All kidding aside, let me tell you something, and this will show my age a little bit, but back in the 1970s, there was a comedian named Flip Wilson who made the phrase popular, the devil made me do it. Now let me ask you a question. Can the devil make you do anything? And the answer is no. And I say that because in 1 John chapter 4, verse 4, just the second half of the verse, it says, therefore, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And of course, he that is in you is the Holy Spirit. So greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. So you just need to rely on the Holy Spirit to resist temptation. So can the Satan make you sin? The answer is no. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, it says this, no temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond your ability, but with the temptation, he will also provide the way of escape that you may be able to endure it. So God will provide a way of escape. So do you have to sin when you are tempted? And the answer is no. But at the same time,
Satan can be really persuasive. But let me tell you something. The closer you walk with God, the harder it will be for Satan to get you to fall into temptation. Did you get that? The closer you walk with God, the harder it will be for Satan to get you to fall into temptation. And we're going to look this morning at Jesus' temptations in Matthew 4. Because who better to learn from than Jesus himself? So turn to Matthew chapter 4 with me and follow along as we go through these verses. In verse 1, it says this. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. You know, verse 1 starts out with the word then. Then Jesus, so what happened right prior to this? Right prior to this, and I'm not going to read it, but if you look at the end of chapter 3 of Matthew, it's the baptism of Jesus. Jesus was baptized by John in the Jordan River. And then, after the baptism, then he's led into the Spirit, into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. I mean, I think it's safe to say that this comes after the baptism of Jesus. That means that Jesus was on a spiritual high before the temptation. I mean, Jesus saw heaven opened. Jesus saw a dove descending on him. Jesus heard the words, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." Imagine the high that Jesus is on. And then he goes from that to the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. But the point is this. Don't ever let down your guard. You think, "I'm on a spiritual high, it can't happen now." But don't ever let down your guard. Just remember, though, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. We need to rely on the Holy Spirit to resist temptation. As soon as you think, "I got this, I can do this, Satan can't get me now," do you notice what you're relying on when you say that? It's, "I got this, I can do this now." You're not relying on the Holy Spirit any longer, and that's just when Satan will get you. And let me tell you something. Satan wants to destroy you. And I say that, and I'm going to back it up with Luke 22. Verse 31, where it says there, "Simon, Simon, behold, Satan demands to have you that he might sift you like wheat." The word in that verse, the word "you" is plural, meaning not only did Satan desire to have Peter, Satan desires to have each one of you. And this happened right after the disciples were having a dispute about who was the greatest among them. And then Satan demands to have Peter. And he also demands to have you, to destroy you, to crush you. In verse 32 there, I'm not going to read it, but there in verse 32, Jesus is praying for Peter. And he's also praying for us, that our faith would not fail us. Remember, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Why do I say that Satan wants to destroy you? Look at 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. And it says there, "Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour." Does that sound like Satan wants to destroy you? Yeah. That's his goal. That's Satan's goal, to destroy you. Why wouldn't he want to destroy you? Because he knows eventually he's going to be destroyed, and he wants to take as many of you with him as he can. And this explains the different names that Satan is called in the Bible. Satan is not only called Satan, he's called the devil, he's called the tempter, He's called the evil one. He's called the enemy. He's called the liar. He's called the father of lies. He's called a murderer. He's called the ruler of this world. He's called the accuser. He's called the deceiver. He's called an angel of light. Yeah, get that. He tries to portray himself as good. He's called an adversary, a roaring lion, a dragon, and a serpent. And we're going to focus this morning on Satan as a tempter. And I got to make this clear. It says there in verse 1 that Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. It was the devil that was doing the tempting, not God. Turn to James chapter 1, verse 13, where it says there, "Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one." When you're tempted, make it clear that it's Satan that's doing the tempting. So why would God allow it? God allows it, but he doesn't do it. God allows it to grow you. In James 1, verse 2, and I'm not going to turn there, but it says, "Count it all joy when you face trials and temptations of various kind." Why would you count it all joy? You count it all joy because these types of trials and temptations grow you. If you never face any trials and temptations in life, you would never grow. And Jesus was tempted, just like we are, but Jesus never sinned. But you could ask the question, why was Jesus tempted? Because Jesus certainly didn't need to grow. He was the Son of God. So why was Jesus tempted? He was tempted so that he could identify with us. In Hebrews chapter 2, verse 18, it says this, "For because he himself has suffered when tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted." And he himself there is talking about Jesus. Over to chapter 4, verse 15, still in Hebrews. "For we do not have a high priest," and the high priest is Jesus, "we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin." Yeah, Jesus was tempted in every way like we are, yet without sin. He can relate to us. Yeah, Jesus never fell into temptation. He remained sinless. And Jesus being able to endure temptation without sin demonstrates his holiness. It demonstrates his sinless nature. And that is so important because it allows him to address our sin problem. And we're going to come back to that at the end of the sermon. But let's look now at the temptations of Jesus. Look at Matthew chapter 4, verses 2 to 4. "And after fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. And the tempter came and said to him, 'If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread.' But he answered, 'It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God.'" You know, Jesus had just spent 40 days and 40 nights fasting. To say he was hungry would be an understatement. So what is Satan appealing to here? He's appealing to the lust of the flesh. He says to Jesus, Satan is basically saying to Jesus, "Take care of yourself. You're hungry. And if you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread." Better stated, instead of "if," it should be "since you are the Son of God." Satan knew who Jesus was. Satan never questioned Jesus' deity, but he challenged him to prove it by demonstrating a miraculous turning of stones into bread. Could Jesus have done it? Could he have turned those stones into bread? And the answer is yes. But he never did miraculous miracles for his own personal gain. He could have done it. He turned water into wine. He miraculously fed 4,000 people on one occasion. He miraculously fed 5,000 people on another occasion. He could have done it. And the trap here that Satan is using is God is not adequately providing for you. You need to take things into your own hands. God's not adequately providing for you. It's the same trap that Satan used on Eve in the garden. Did God really say, you must not eat from all the trees in the garden? And you said, oh, we can eat from the trees in the garden, just not that one in the center of the garden. Because God knows, or Satan said, because God said, you will die. And Satan says, you won't die. God's denying you something. That's what Satan was telling to Eve. God is denying you something. God knows when you eat of that tree, you will be like God. God's denying you something. And Satan is still using that temptation on us today. God's denying you something. That is why people buy things they can't afford. That is why people engage in premarital sex. That is why people engage in extramarital sex, because God is denying you something. You're not getting everything you deserve. That's why people are going to porn sites, they're going to drugs and the alcohol, because God's denying you something. I'm going to tell you something. God's not denying you anything. When God says don't do certain things, He's setting up boundaries for you because He loves you. And He loves you enough to give you boundaries that are for your own good. He's not denying you anything. God loves you. And Jesus answers Satan there in verse 4. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. That's a direct quote from Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3. Jesus is going to use the ancient words of the Bible as his defense. I'm not going to turn to these, but God's word tells you how to respond when you are tempted. In James 4, verse 7, it says, submit to God, resist the devil. 1 Peter 5, 8 says, be self-controlled and alert. 1 Peter 5, 9 says, resist the devil, stand firm in the faith. Ephesians 4, 27 says, don't give Satan a foothold. 1 Corinthians 6, 18 says, flee from sexual immorality. 2 Timothy 2, 22 says, flee the evil desires of youth. You get the point. Use God's word when you're tempted. And I think a great example of fleeing or resisting might be Joseph from the Old Testament. When Mrs. Potiphar came on to him, he ran. He got out of there. Sometimes I think we don't get this. Sometimes I think we can stay put and pray for strength. You don't stay put and pray for strength. You flee, you run, you get out of there. It's kind of ridiculous to stay put and pray for strength. There are times we should just run. Remember, Satan's goal is to ruin you. I mean, you all heard of Murphy's Law. Anything that can go wrong will. Well, Satan's law is anyone I can ruin, I will ruin. The next temptation. Go to Matthew 4, look at verses 5 to 7. Then the devil took him to the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone. And Jesus said to him, again it is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. In the first temptation, Satan questioned God's provision. And now, Satan is questioning God's protection. He takes Jesus to the pinnacle of the temple and says, throw yourself down, God will protect you. And I looked it up. You know, how high was it from the pinnacle of the temple to the valley below? It was 450-foot drop. The only way you're going to survive that is if God miraculously protects you. And then Satan goes to Scripture himself. I mean, Satan has the idea, okay, Jesus used scripture on me on the first temptation. Now I'm going to turn around and use scripture on Satan. But the only problem was that Satan took scripture out of context. And when Satan quoted from Psalms 91, verses 11 and 12, he took it out of context and he left out the words, to keep you in all your ways. He did not finish the verse. Psalms 91 was never meant to be used that God would protect you physically no matter what you silly thing that you did. And I think what it really means is God will protect you spiritually. Because we all know that God doesn't protect us physically if we do something crazy. I mean, you can't go down out there on the road and drive down the road 100 miles an hour and think God's got this. That's spiritual protection that Psalms 91 is referring to. And Jesus again goes to the Word of God in verse 7. And this is a quote from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 16. Do not put the Lord your God to the test. The next temptation. Look at Matthew 4, verses 8 to 10. Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, all these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me. And then Jesus said to him again, be gone, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. You know, the first temptation, Satan questioned God's provision. The second temptation, Satan questioned God's protection. Now Satan is questioning God's promises. You know, the question is asked, were the kingdoms of the world Satan's to give to Jesus? And the answer is yes. Because Satan is called the prince of this world. Satan could offer these kingdoms to Jesus. All Jesus had to do was bow down and worship Satan. Just this once. And it would have been so easy for Jesus to rationalize, this would be so much easier than the cross. The temptation here is to bypass the cross. And it's all yours. Satan is saying, it's all yours. All you need to do is bow down and worship me. Exactly what Satan wanted from the beginning. Remember, Satan was a fallen angel. He wanted to be like God. He wanted to be worshipped like God. And all he's asking of Jesus is, worship me just this once before the cross. What did God promise to Jesus after the cross? Didn't he promise him everything? In Philippians 2, verses 9 to 11. Therefore God has highly exalted him, and this is after the cross. Therefore God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God. God highly exalted him after the cross. Satan was trying to get him to do this before the cross. And again, Jesus quotes from the Word of God, these ancient words again, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve, from Deuteronomy 6:13. And I need to say, who you worship, you also serve. Who you worship, you also serve. They go together. You know, when you worship someone, you will want to serve them. And I wish I could say, when you resist temptation and you win, that Satan will leave you alone. But he won't. He's going to come back at you time and time and time again. Look at verse 11. Then the devil left, and behold, angels came and were ministering to him. But if you go to Luke's gospel, at the end of the temptation, it says, until a more opportune time. So Satan kept hounding Jesus time and time and time again to sin. And I got to say this too, be careful. Be careful when you start to rationalize. You're like the woman in the story at the beginning, I can just try this dress on. Or when you start to rationalize, no one will know. Or it won't hurt anyone. Or I can stop this at any time. Those are dangerous statements. Because Satan never gives up. And Jesus faced temptation time and time again, yet he was tempted in every way like we were, back to Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15, tempted in every way like we were, yet without sin. So it's a practical application yet. What was Jesus' defense against Satan when he was tempted? Of course, it was the Word of God, those ancient words. Three temptations, three times, it is written. If you go to the armor of God found in Ephesians chapter 6, the sword of the Spirit is the Word of God. A sword is used to defend. We need the Word of God to defend ourselves from Satan. And Psalms 119 points this out so well. In verses 9 to 11 of Psalms 119, how can a young man keep his way pure? By guarding it according to your word. With my whole heart I will seek you. Let me not wander from your commandments. That's another word for word. I have stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. It points out the importance of the Word of God. I honestly believe you cannot defend yourself against Satan without knowing the Word of God. Another application, and this one might not be quite as obvious here, but Jesus had a real connection to God. A real connection to God. Listen to this. When Jesus used God's word to defend against temptation, you hear his connection to God. In verse 4, he says, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. In verse 7, his defense, do not put the Lord your God to the test. In verse 10, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. God is mentioned every time he's defending himself. Jesus had a real closeness with God, and he used that to defend against temptation. And that closeness, I believe, is brought about by a healthy prayer life. And we too, not only do we need the Word of God, we need a healthy prayer life. We need to be communicating with God to resist temptation. In Matthew 26, verse 14, verse 41, watch and pray. Get that. Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak. We need to be in prayer that we do not fall into temptation. And the Lord said, when he taught the disciples how to pray, lead us not into temptation. You know, we already talked about the importance of fleeing. I said it's kind of ridiculous to stay in a place where you're being tempted and not get out of there. Another thing, practical application, is when you're being tempted, make yourself accountable to someone. Sometimes you need to take someone alongside of you and say, I am really struggling with this. Can you help me? Can you keep me accountable? And then that person can come back and ask you, how are you doing? Because if you have to answer to someone, it's a little more easy to not fall into temptation. Another thing, you might not have thought of this, but sometimes it's a temptation to do nothing. It's called the sin of omission. You know, Dietrich Bonhoeffer said this, silence in the face of evil is evil itself. Silence in the face of evil is evil itself. Not to speak is to speak. Not to act is to act. Those are the words of Dietrich Bonhoeffer. And let me back this up with a true story. There was a church that was negotiating for the purpose of either renting a property or purchasing a property. I'm not sure which. But anyway, the owner of that property offered it to the church at a less value than it was worth and said these words. The way I figure it, this is the words of the owner to the pastor of a church. The way I figure it, it might be just enough to get me into heaven by offering a property to a church at less than its value. And the pastor said, I was tempted to say nothing. Would that have been a sin? Because that pastor knew that the only way into heaven was through Jesus Christ. So sometimes we're tempted to do nothing, say nothing. Another thing is, don't be discouraged. Because we all fall sometimes into sin. None of us is sinless. We never will be. But hopefully as you grow in your Christian walk, that you will sin less than what you used to. And the good news is, as Hebrews 4:15 pointed out, Jesus was tempted in every way as we are, yet without sin. We all know from Romans 3:23 that the wages of sin is death. So we all know what we deserve. Every one of us deserves death. But here's the good news. Since Jesus had no sin of his own, he was able to die and offer himself for our sins. He died in our place. He died in our place. And all we need to do is accept Jesus Christ to avoid death. And I'm talking about avoid death. I'm talking about avoid spiritual death. I'm talking about avoid hell. And let me end with a story that illustrates this. And I'm going to admit, illustrations are hard to come by. And this is not original with me. I don't know who it comes from. I don't know who to give credit to either. But this goes back to the prairie days. When one day, after months of travel through the prairie, a group of travelers approached the top of a hill and were met with a terrifying sight. A great wall of fire was blowing toward them. The prairie was engulfed in flames, and it was coming at them fast. And they thought escape was impossible. Death seemed a sure thing. When the leader of that group rushed to the rear of the group and quickly started another fire. Remember, the wind was going, it was bringing fire toward them so that fire behind them would take the fire away from them. And as the fire that was coming toward them grew closer and closer, the group moved to the fire, to the burned out area behind them, and they were saved. The point is this, death is approaching us. I'm talking about spiritual death is approaching us. But the death behind us is the death that Jesus Christ has already died. And all we need to do is move from here to Jesus Christ, and we can be saved. It's that simple. Remember, there's no condemnation in Jesus Christ. In 1912, when the Titanic went down, they posted two lists. The one list said lost, and the other list said saved. And we're all sinners. We all fall into temptation, probably more often than we like to admit. But Jesus never sinned. And Jesus can move you from the lost list to the saved list. Jesus is the only way. Let us pray. Oh God, our Father, we thank you. We thank you that even though death was approaching us, that you sent your Son You sent your Son to die the death that we deserved. You sent your Son to die on that cruel, ugly, and brutal cross. And thank you, Jesus, for taking our place. And Lord, when we're tempted too, I pray that we might use the same defense that Jesus used. And we might go to the ancient words that are long preserved for us. And I pray too, we might be in constant communication with you, our Father, to help us resist those temptations. And Lord, if there's anyone who has not put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ, and they see that death, that fire wall approaching them, that death approaching them, that they might move into the death that Jesus already has done. May this be a day of salvation. And we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. And I think I am going to extend an invitation. If death is approaching you, I'm talking about spiritual death, and you have never named the name of Jesus Christ, I think this wouldn't be, there wouldn't be any greater day, any better day than to name Jesus as your Savior today. Just come forward. I'll pray with you. Okay, let's sing our closing.
Thank you.
for benediction from Psalms 139. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Amen.